greatest day in history. Death is beaten, you have rescued me. Sing it out, Jesus is alive. Cross the empty grave, life eternal, you have won the day. Shout it out, Jesus is alive. He's alive. And oh, happy day, happy day. You washed my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day. I'll never be the same. Forever I am changed. I stand in that place, free at last, meeting face to face. I am yours, Jesus, you are mine. Endless joy, perfect peace, earthly pain finally will cease. Celebrate, Jesus is alive. He's a what? He's alive. You wash my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day. I'll never be the same. Forever I am changed. And oh, what a glorious day. What a glorious way that you have saved me. And oh, what a glorious day. What a glorious name. We love you, Jesus. And oh, happy day, happy day. Sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day. I'll never be the same. Oh, oh, happy day, happy day. You wash my sin away. Oh, oh, happy day, happy day. I'll never be the same. Forever I am changed. I'll never be the same. Amen. Amen. God, we give you praise. We have gathered because of you, Jesus. We want to lift you up. We want to lift you up. When you are lifted up, people are saved. People are redeemed. People are healed. People are forgiven. Lord, you grant the joy, the deeper joy that we want. You grant the peace, the deeper peace that we want. Lord, as we lift you up, God, would you bless us, Lord, and help us to bring you glory because of what you do in us and through us and among us. We ask for this in Jesus' name. Amen. Darkness clouds the day when we are afraid. You are there. When trouble closes in, it's hard to trust again. You are there. And we fix our eyes on you. Our hope is found in you.
through our glorious, almighty, infinite and holy, gracious, full of mercy, love without end, and magnificent God, our hearts are full of wonder, captured by your beauty, falling on our knees, we worship you alone, magnificent God. We bow before all you are. Gathered in this place to glorify your name, you are here. Your presence is revealed as hearts are being healed. You are here. And we lift our eyes to you. Our hope is found where? In you. Cause you are glorious, almighty, infinite and holy, gracious, full of mercy, love without end, and magnificent God, magnificent God. Our hearts are full of wonder, captured by your beauty, falling on our knees, we worship you alone, magnificent God, we bow before all you are. We belong to you, oh God. Belong to you, oh God. Yes, we belong to you, oh God. Yes, we belong to you, oh God. You are glorious, almighty, infinite and holy, gracious, full of mercy, love without end, and magnificent God, our hearts are full of wonder, captured by your beauty, falling on our knees, we worship you alone, magnificent God, we bow before all you are, magnificent God. Bow before all you are.
Amen. Amen. You can be seated for a moment. You can be seated for a moment.
Morning, everyone. Thank you. First things, if you're new with us, welcome this morning. We'd love to get to know you better, so please fill out one of these guest cards and drop it in the offering boxes in the back. Or if you're a regular church member and you have a prayer request, please put it on here. And again, put it in the offering box in the back. We'd love to pray for you. Just a couple announcements today, so I'll consult the cheat sheet. We will have a family meeting today, but 10 minutes after the service, so please stick around if you're a church member. And like I said, we'll have the family meeting just a little bit after the end of the service. Men's breakfast this week, Tuesday at 8:30. Again, Tuesday at 8:30 for men's breakfast. And the last but not least is the ladies' Bible study. We'll be starting on September 17th. So please keep a heads up for more info. And there'll be a sign-up sheet next weekend. And that's it.
No praise can define you, no thought can contain you, God. No other outshine you. No power can defeat you, God.
Song. Some of you don't know this, but one of the elders caught it and pointed it out to me. He says, you know, this is your last Sunday being the official worship leader. How about that? How about that? He is our God. He's my God. And he allows us to go through difficulty so that we can know him better. And he shows that he's more powerful than anything we could go through. And each one of us need to discover that. Let's sing to him. In the middle of the night, when worry finds me, in the middle of a fight, when strength is gone, in the middle of a fire, when fear is closing in, you are my song. You're my hope. When hope is gone, so I will cast my cares on you, the Almighty. I will cast my cares on you, 'cause you're good.
I will cast my cares on you, 'cause you love me. You love me, oh, 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 because you love me. In the middle of the night, when worry finds me, in the middle of a fight, when strength is gone, in the middle of a fire, when fear is closing in, you are my song. You're my hope when hope is gone. So I will cast my cares on you, the Almighty. I will cast my cares on you, 'cause you're good. I will cast my cares on you, 'cause you love me. You love me, oh, 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 because you love me, oh, 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 because you love me. God of glory, you are able through your power to be faithful. God of mercy, every moment you are near to me.
Sing, God of glory.
God of glory, you are able through your power to be faithful. God of mercy, every moment you are near to me.
So I'll cast my cares.
I will cast my cares on you, the Almighty. I will cast my cares on you, 'cause you're good. I will cast my cares on you, 'cause you love.
Thank you, Lord.
You love me, oh, 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 because you love me, oh, 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 because you love me. In the middle of the night, I'll pray with confidence. In the middle of a fight, you're greater still. In the middle of a fire, your love is holding me. You are my song. You're my hope when hope is gone. So I will cast my cares on you, the Almighty. I will cast my cares on you, 'cause you're good. I will cast my cares on you, 'cause you love me. You love me, oh, 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 because you love me, oh, 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 because you love me. Man of sorrows, Lamb of God, by his own betrayed, the sin of man and wrath of God has been on Jesus laid. Silent as he stood accused, beaten, mocked, and scorned, and bowing to the Father's will, he took a crown of thorns. out. Hallelujah. Praise and honor unto thee. Sent of heaven, God's own Son, to purchase and redeem and reconcile the very ones who nailed him to that tree. Oh, that rugged cross, my salvation, where your love poured out over me. Now my soul cries out, hallelujah, praise and honor unto thee.
And now my debt is paid, it is paid in full by the precious blood that my Jesus spilled. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me. Whom the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. Now my debt is paid, it is paid in full by the precious blood that my Jesus spilled. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me. Whom the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. Oh, that rugged cross, my salvation, where your love poured out over me. Now my soul cries out, hallelujah, praise and honor unto thee. See, the stone is rolled away, and behold the empty tomb.
And how do we respond to sing hallelujah?
Hallelujah. God be praised, he's risen from the grave. Oh, that rugged cross, my salvation, where your love poured out over me. Now my soul cries out, hallelujah, praise and honor.
Pray with me. Lord, I just think of the song we just sang, Man of Sorrows, and what a beautiful picture of the gospel, that we are reconciled to you through your Son, and that in this world we may face tribulation, but we are to fear not, because you have overcome the world. Lord, in these strange times, help us to seek first your kingdom. Your word says that in your presence there is fullness of joy, in your right hand there are pleasures forever. So thank you for even just the privilege of being able to worship you today. We pray for Sam, pray for wisdom that he could rightly divide the word of truth. And help us, Lord, not just to be hearers only, but doers also. Conform us to your image, God. We thank you and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Children, I heard a pitter-patter of feet. That caught my attention. Children age 3 through 3rd grade, you're welcome to go back for children's church. Our parents, you're welcome to keep them with you if you would like to do that instead. Welcome the Hansons. Somebody said the 90s band. What was that? A comment about? You didn't catch that, the Hansons. Yeah, get a chance to interact with them a little bit after the service. How's everybody doing? You know, we're getting towards the end of 1 Thessalonians where he's got these bullet point statements of do this, do this, do this, don't do this, don't do that. And I have to be honest with you, there was part of me that just thought, well, this should be easy. This should be easy. These verses, no, not so much. I tell you what, when you dig into God's word, it's a well. It's a well. There's a lot. And so I'm grateful for the prayer because we have a lot to cover this morning. And to be honest with you, I don't even know if all my notes are the way they need to be. And you're going to get a chuckle out of this when you read the scripture and you see what this message is about. I feel like God's like, wait, who's in charge here? It's like, I'm always trying to acknowledge that you're in charge, Lord. You don't have to do this to me. But I have one expression that I want to throw out your way that I do think kind of helps us prime the pump a little bit to think about what this passage, I think, is about and what Paul's trying to get at. The expression is, don't throw the baby out with the bathwater. You guys ever heard that before? It's an awful image, right? Some people actually try to do a comic of that. I'm like, that's not meant to be drawn. It's just supposed to be thought. And it's driving at what exactly? It's trying to help us to use discernment. Use discernment. Don't throw the baby out with the bathwater. There's something precious. There's something important. There's something life-giving. And as you're trying to get rid of some other things that might not be, don't throw all of it out. Okay? As we have been looking at Paul's closing comments in his letter to the believers in Thessalonica, I still can't. Lord, one more week, and then we're done with this book, right? We listened to his urging for them to have a good relationship with their leaders. Then he instructed them on how they are to love one another through admonishment, encouragement, or help. And then he commanded them to rejoice always, pray constantly, and give thanks in everything, not only individually, but corporately. Okay? Because this is God's will for us. And now, speaking of God, he gives them commands related to what I believe is discernment. What they need to do, not do, in order to continue to thrive as a church, as it relates to how God, the Holy Spirit, ministers to and through them. So turn with me to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, starting at verse 19. Now, do you get my earlier comment? Do not quench the Spirit. As some of you pray, you say, Lord, please help Sam. Give him the words that he needs to share with us so that we are edified as your church. Right? And so basically what are you praying is that God's Spirit who lives inside of me communicates through his word and he gives me understanding and he helps me. And so, and you've heard me say it. I said, you know, if you're going to pray for me for the message, pray on Monday. Like start Monday because I'm starting to study on Monday. I didn't write this thing last night. Okay? But at the same time, sometimes God says, okay, you thought you knew everything you were supposed to say, but I am going to make you wait because I just want to make sure that you know, and we all know, who we're really listening for. And I tell you what, I always try to keep that in mind, that it's not about Sam Cathy that we're listening, right? Thank the Lord Jesus for that. We want to hear from God. And God chooses to use people to help bring about his messages. That's how we got the Bible, isn't it? God used people through the power of his Holy Spirit to bring about messages that he wants his church to know. That's one aspect of the ministry of the Holy Spirit. And so he says, do not quench the Spirit. Now, Spirit, very common word in the New Testament, referring to even our spirit. It's pneuma. It's the same thing, same word. We could tell the difference. The translators could tell the difference because it would be more specific. If it said the Spirit, it would either leave it at that or the spirit of man, and then making it very clear. Now, our translations are kind to us and make it a little easier, we use capital letters, right? So you see capital S, you know it's talking about the Spirit of God. Little s, that's talking about our spirit. In the Greek, it's actually the same word, and so we determine it based upon context. Still with me? Although the Spirit of God takes form a couple of times, as a dove or flames of fire, we don't see the Spirit of God. We see and feel the effects, the workings of God's Spirit. This is the conversation that Nicodemus had with Jesus when Jesus was telling him, you need to be born again. And he asked the question, well, what does that mean? What does that mean? So Jesus answers him and says, truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh. That which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I said to you, you must be born again. The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear its sound, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. You also see the effect of the wind. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. Right? You talk to people and find out their testimony, and you hear stories here and there. And, I mean, even just in the past couple of weeks, I heard somebody say, oh, my goodness, they so changed, just turned around. Especially, I mean, we can see it in kids. Attitude, complete change when they fully surrendered their life to Jesus and said, I need you. I need to be forgiven. Save me. And then what happens? Now, when we talk about the Spirit of God, I mean, I grew up in a Baptist church. I've gone into Bible churches, and to be honest with you, sometimes I think we're afraid of talking about it. Talking about God, the Holy Spirit, and that's part of, I think, what the challenge is for them here, and it's partly a challenge for us too. And because sometimes we struggle with what we can't see and what we can't quite understand or can't interpret, or somebody does something we think is just strange, and we go, I don't want to have anything to do with that. Or somebody may do something that could be just wrong, and they may be trying to associate themselves with God the Holy Spirit. And so we go, okay, I don't want anything to do with that. I'll just pray to Jesus. I'll just talk to the Father, and I'm not going to worry about the Holy Spirit, and he's going to do his thing anyway. But that's not quite right. And we all need to continue to grow in our understanding of who God is, the Godhead, the Trinity, the best we can. I mean, if I were to ask you this question, where is Jesus? How would you respond? Where is Jesus? Well, we are taught as kids, pray and ask Jesus where? Into your heart. So is he in your heart? There's a Trinity question for you. Well, yes. No. No, yes. Oh, it's yes and no. It's yes and no, because the scripture says, where is Jesus? Right hand of the Father. He's on his throne. One day he's going to be coming back. So wait a minute. Well, who's here? God, the Holy Spirit. And in the scriptures, God has no problems interchanging the Spirit of Christ, right? No problem. But the Godhead, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, guess who's living here? God, the Holy Spirit. That's the truth. That's what Scripture teach. I don't have to be afraid. I'm like, what's going to happen to me now if I start to really think that way? Am I going to get weird? No, but I would say you need to get on fire. You need to be on fire. If you say, Jesus, sit on the throne of my life, and you do focus on Jesus, the Holy Spirit's going to be at work. He's going to make you more on fire for him. That's what's going to happen. And you do have to be okay with being different. 1 Thessalonians, in the beginning of his letter, Paul said to them, he said, we know, brothers, loved by God, that he has chosen you, because our gospel came to you not only in word, but also in power, and in the Holy Spirit, and in full conviction. So Paul saw the results of God the Holy Spirit working in their lives. And it's interesting, too, because you start to see that. And I've noticed that, too. Have you ever shared the good news with someone the best you knew how? You shared your testimony with them, shared what the Bible had to say, shared about Jesus. Right? I told you that story about my wife. I told her about how I came to know Jesus when I was dying as a 5-year-old. And I said, what do you think about that? She was like, oh, I'm so glad you didn't die. Right over the head, right? And I've done that for weeks. I witness other people, and they go, whoosh, right over the head. And what I found that out. I was like, I'm presenting the gospel. What else is necessary? Amen. God has to save people. They don't save themselves, and neither do I. I don't save nobody. Don't save anybody. Right? God saves. His Holy Spirit saves. Regenerates. Convicts. And that's, you hear testimony. Carmen's testimony, too. I've shared that. When the timing was right, when God decided it was right, and gave me more words to share with her that she needed to hear, and the Holy Spirit was convicting her and ministering to her and saying, you better listen, this is the truth. And she was locked in. And she didn't even know what was happening. And God saved her. That's sometimes your story. I don't know what happened. All I know is that I was convicted, I prayed, I cried out to God, and then I've just grown in relationship with him. Now I look back and go, whoa, God saved me. God saved me. The person of God, the Holy Spirit, was involved in creation. He is one with the Father and the Son, and yet he has different functions. He convicts, he saves, he sanctifies, he guides, he empowers, and he gives inspiring messages to people to speak for him. He always has. Even in the Old Testament, that's where we get the prophecies. That's where we get any of the old scripture or the new, right? We believe now, we call this the Word of God. We call this the Word of God because we believe that God inspired, the Holy Spirit spoke to people and they wrote it down, and the church was like, that wasn't just them talking. God has spoke. And by the grace of God, he's given us the Word recorded, and we hold on to it. In the Old Testament, he not only, he came upon people, it said, and yet in the New Testament, it says he is within us. Anyone who believes receives God the Holy Spirit. Are you uncomfortable with that? No. No. Especially when you really try to live for him, right? And you're still trying to operate in the sinful nature, and it's not working. So you dumb down the scriptures, right? That's what you do. Lower the standard. Let's do that. So our flesh can try to. And then God says, no, I'm going to make it worse. I'm going to let you fail even more until you realize that you need me to live for me. You need me to live for me. I'd encourage you, read Paul's letters again here and there. You know, when I was in seminary, I took a youth ministry class, and I was still impacted by his first assignment. He said, this is what I want you to do before next class. I want you to go home, and I want you to read the book of Acts 3 times. The first time you read it, I want you to focus on evangelism. Just have that in your mind. Put that filter up. Recognize every aspect of evangelism that you can see in Scripture. Read through entire book of Acts. And he says, the second time, I want you to read through all of it. I want you to focus in on the discipleship aspect of, and what I mean by that is you're trying to help a believer, a new believer, grow. I want you just to focus on that. Put a filter on, read through Acts again, pick up on every instance and case of that. And he said, the third time you read through it, I want you to focus on the presence of God, the Holy Spirit, and how he was involved. I want you to focus in on that. And that was a little different, right? I was always kind of taught, when you open up the Bible, you know, you just let it speak. Be just completely open to whatever it has to say. And that's good. That's good, but I'm telling you, I was really impacted by that. And so I just want to encourage you to give that consideration. Pick one of Paul's letters, pick Acts. Pick John 14 through 16. And seriously, just focus on what does God have to say about God the Holy Spirit. God the Holy Spirit has been at work, is at work, will continue to be at work in and among us to bring people to salvation, to help believers to thrive as the church. And so he tells them, don't quench the Spirit. don't stifle, don't suppress, don't extinguish. Okay, the word there shows up in a few passages of Scripture. Here's one of them, Matthew 25:8. It says, and the foolish, now this is the parable that Jesus is giving about the 10 virgins, and he's given this picture of Jesus coming back. He's the bridegroom. And so they're waiting for him, okay? But there was some that were prepared and waiting for him for real, and the other ones didn't. And so the foolish, he refers to them as, said to the wise, give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out. They're going out. The same word shows up in Ephesians 6:16. In all circumstances, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish the flaming darts of the evil one. You know, I talked earlier about being on fire for God. Sometimes we might say that. We've sang it, haven't we? My soul on fire. I mean, there are fires that, I always get lost when I get in here. Which way is north? That way? Okay. There's some fires that we want to go out, right? But there's some fires we don't. Sometimes we're starting the wrong fires, and we're not fanning into flame the right ones. Get too excited. Not about the wrong things, sure. Listen to Jeremiah. Jeremiah says in chapter 20, 8 through 10, for whenever I speak, I cry out, I shout, violence and destruction, for the word of the Lord has become for me a reproach and a derision all day long. If I say, I will not mention him or speak any more in his name, there is in my heart, as it were, a burning fire shut up in my bones, and I am weary with holding it in, and I cannot. I mean, God gave him some bad news, right, and some rough news to share. He was admonishing. He was rebuking. And he says, I'd rather not, but I can't. I have to. The Holy Spirit was stirring in him so much, the truth, that he had to. This is one of the ministries of God, the Holy Spirit. Messages. He inspired people to speak. When Peter preached at Pentecost, he said, this is what was uttered through the prophet Joel. And then later on, he mentions how the Holy Spirit spoke through King David. He refers to David as a prophet in Acts 2:30. Prophets. Prophet was someone, if they were labeled that, then people understood that when you want to hear from the Lord, that seems to be somebody who's not only listening, but God is speaking through. And the kings was like, he's got all these advisors, and he was like, nobody's telling me the truth. Where's Samuel? He knew Samuel was a true prophet, and he could receive an inspired message, a true message from God. And so we have this. There's other writings in the Old Testament, Isaiah, Ezekiel, Amos, Zechariah, some used by God to predict future events, or some very clearly or not so clearly predicting the coming of the Messiah and where he would come from and what he would be like and what would happen to him. Some of the writing was just simply to rebuke them for current behavior or how it violated God's laws, but that was also referred to as prophecy. And a lot of times we hear prophecy, and that's, I don't know about you, but sometimes that immediately I think it's, oh, it's telling about things that are yet to come. But that's not a full picture of what prophesying is. It's truth-telling, inspired truth-telling from God. Sometimes it is just convicting and rebuking. And you see that in those books in the Old Testament. When's the last time you read the book of Amos? Yeah. Zephaniah. You're going to meet him one day. He might ask you, so what'd you think of my letter? Oh, you, what's your name again? I read Zechariah. Yeah, I did that once. I had a Bible study. Talked about the Old Testament. It was like, oh, what if that happened? And I thought, that's right. Is this God's word? Is it God's word? Can I study any book of the Bible? Some might be more difficult than others, but can I study any book of the Bible and hear from God? Something? And so I had a small Bible study, and I was like, yes, we're going to study Zephaniah. There's not a lot of resources out there. I had to go to the seminary to get some more resources and started studying. And I was encouraged by the message in Zephaniah. I'm glad it wasn't as long, because it was hard. But when we talk about prophecy, couple of words that people have used to try to be helpful to us is they say it's either foretelling or forthtelling. Anybody ever heard that before? You know, the foretelling is I'm telling something before it's happened. The forthtelling is I'm talking about current things. It's right there. It's what I was talking about. Rebuking somebody because the law says this, you're not living this way, and now I'm prophesying on God's behalf. I'm speaking on God's behalf. You need to repent. And God inspires that, and it happened, and it was happening, okay? In the early church, it was happening. Acts 11:27 says, and now in these days, Acts 11, the church has already started. Now in these days, prophets came down from Jerusalem to Antioch, and one of them named Agabus stood up and foretold by the Spirit that there would be a great famine over the world, over all the world. And then Luke was investigating this. He's the one that wrote Acts. He put in parenthesis, this took place in the days of Claudius. And so he predicted it, and basically Luke is saying, and it happened. It happened. And so the disciples, when they heard Agabus speak, the disciples determined everyone according to his ability to send relief to the brothers living in Judea. And they did so, sending it to the elders by the hand of Barnabas and Saul, who we know now as Paul. God was raising up people in the church to help them do something. God is always, when he speaks, he's eliciting a response. It may be to believe. It may be to repent. Or it may be to obey. And so Paul says to them in the next verse, verse 20, he says, do not despise prophecies. Now again, when I first studied this, I thought I was going to go this direction, and then I studied it, and I was like, oh, okay. Lord, you're going to have to help me understand. Now all of a sudden I'm asking myself, why is Paul saying this to this church? I mean, he seemed pretty encouraged by the church, but then his last few comments, do this, don't do that, do this, and don't quench the Spirit. Don't despise prophecies. Were they? I don't know. I never got the impression that they didn't want to hear from God. It seemed like they wanted to hear from God. So what was happening here? Why is Paul telling them this? Yeah, just a little bit of research, came across this one piece of information related to what was going on in their city. I'm just going to read it to you. It says, in the city of Thessalonica, speaking manifestations were associated with the cult of Isis and Serapis. And so given the general questions about oracles and speaking that existed at the time, plus the way the church had distanced itself from pagan cults, we saw they were already trying to do that in verse 9 of chapter 1, we can well identify the conditions in the environment that would have provoked some people to reject prophecy. So there are some other, and that's what I'm saying. Sometimes we do that, right? Why don't we go door to door in Paris? Right? All of a sudden, we don't do that anymore. No, we couldn't. Not that we couldn't. How about we go in threes and really throw them off, right? Or four, you know? Then they'll know. Don't wear a name tag, right? But Satan has a way of trying to... Satan's a copycat. He doesn't create nothing. He takes what God makes and he perverts it, distorts it. And so, but what we need to be careful is we need to show discernment. I don't want to have nothing to do with that. Well, God's in it. Okay, what? I need to be where God is. I need to be about what he's doing. And so this idea of prophecy, I'm going to read one more thing to you, and this is a kind of a definition that I came across regarding prophecy. It's discourse emanating from divine inspiration and declaring the purposes of God, whether by reproving or admonishing the wicked or comforting the afflicted or revealing things hidden, especially by foretelling future events. And so even in the definitions, it's like, it's all of it. In some ways, what am I doing? You know, in some ways, I'm prophesying. I'm not telling future events, but I'm trying to explain the truth. I'm trying to apply it to us. And we see, Paul addresses this a lot more in his letters to the Corinthians. The gifts of the Spirit. But he tries to make it clear to them that the church has been founded on this. The church has been founded on, and some of you know these scriptures, on who? The apostles, and he says, and the prophets. Now, some might argue and say, you know, he's talking about the Old Testament prophets. Well, that's true as it relates to things that have been said about the church and how it would come about. The New Covenant did prophesy that. But yet, we just got finished reading it in the Old New Testament. There were those that God was raising up to speak for him, to speak some inspired truth to the church. And they were being identified as, you know, he seems to be a prophet. He's speaking truth. He's coming. Whatever he says that's going to happen, it happens. And so God's speaking through him. And so he says in Ephesians 2:19, so then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens, okay, the saints and the members of God's household, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Christ Jesus himself being the cornerstone, in whom the whole structure joined together grows into a holy temple in the Lord, in which you are being built together into a dwelling place for God by the Spirit. By the Spirit of God. And he continues this train of thought in Ephesians 4 when he says, when he tells them, God has given you the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the shepherds, the teachers, to do what? To equip the saints for the work of the ministry, for building up the body of Christ. And so when God does a work, it is about building us up. Again, I want to show you some scriptures about God, the Holy Spirit, and what God was doing in the early church. Acts 2:17-18. And in the last days it shall be, God declares, that I will pour out my Spirit on all flesh, and your sons and daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even on my male servants and female servants, in those days I will pour out my Spirit, and they shall prophesy. I've had people come up to me after a sermon and said, God spoke to me today through you. Oh, I should have just shut them down, right? No, God doesn't do that anymore. It's the letter. It's the letters. It is the letters. It's more than that. Some of you are going to go away confused today. I'm just going to warn you. So you can come up to me afterwards. You can email me or call me or something like that. At the end of the day, I'm going to tell you this. Don't let John MacArthur tell you who the Holy Spirit is. Let God do that. I like John MacArthur, by the way. I like listening to him. But I always try to be careful. He's a man. Scripture is very clear. The perfect interpreter of Scripture is who? God, the Holy Spirit. He gives us teachers. There's not much that I disagree with John MacArthur on, but there's a few. And I don't have to agree because I know God. And so do you. Some of you are living your Christian life on devotions. Why? Now, I'm talking extremes, okay? I have devotions too, okay? But when's the last time you just read the Bible straight? What are you afraid of? Do you not have the Holy Spirit? Can he not help you understand? I started to make that mistake just recently. I feel like the Lord is guiding me towards teaching on the book of Hebrews this fall. Honestly, I'm scared. That's a big book, and it's hard to understand. And so I grabbed a commentary when I went to Alaska, and I'm like, I'm going to start reading. I'm going to get some help. And I just, as I was trying to read, and I had been reading a little bit, all of a sudden I just lost my enthusiasm, my motivation to read that commentary. And then I was doing a devotion, because I normally do my devotion. I do just read. I read some Psalms. I read Proverbs. Maybe there's another book that I start reading some, just a little bit out of, you know, each day. And then the Lord just guided me to look at Hebrews myself. And I started looking at Hebrews myself. And I just poured over. And the Lord just opened my eyes and started to see some things I just hadn't seen. And I felt like that's what the Lord was saying. Do you not trust me? Don't you think I can help you understand what I've said to you? You're going to lean on someone else your whole life? Lean on me. I'll help you. I'll help you understand. And he blessed me. And he corrected me, basically. You read me first. You write down what I show you and what I help you understand. And then you continue to study. Listen to godly men who have studied my word for a long time and are doing their best to listen to me. And what you'll find is you'll find agreement on the things that I've taught, maybe some things you didn't think of. But my spirit will help you to discern what's true and what's not true. There's a lot of truth on YouTube at the moment. I mean that. Come on now. There's some lot of good stuff there. And it's so easy. Goodness, it's so easy. That's 10 minutes. It's like, man, if only Sam could preach for 10 minutes, that'd be awesome. Be entertaining. No, he's got to stretch it out, doesn't he? I'll get to that, back to that in a minute. I'm skipping a second here. Paul's instructions to the Corinthians, 1 Corinthians 14, 3 and 4. Okay? On the other hand, the one who prophesies speaks to the people for their upbuilding and encouragement and consolation. The one who prophesies builds up the church. That's their purpose. So with you, he says, since you're eager for manifestations of the Spirit, strive to excel in building up the church, because that's the intent of God. And so God was filling new believers with the Spirit, speaking through them for the growth of the church. They needed this more and more because, for a lot of different reasons. I think one is because the church was so new, and guess what they didn't have? They didn't have the New Testament yet. You realize that? Well, when we first started this study on 1 Thessalonians, we discovered that it's one of Paul's first letters. One of his first letters. How many did he write in the New Testament? 13. There's only 27 books in the New Testament, and he wrote half of them. Is that good math? Yeah. How about that? So he wrote 13 of them. You do a little bit more research. None of them were written yet. They were in the process of being written. A lot of the New Testament was written between AD 50 and 70. And he wrote this letter in 50. So they didn't have what we have today. They didn't have what we get to study today. What did they have, though? Right? They had the verbal, the oral teachings of Paul. Are we open to what God has to say? And we always lean on this. You know, if you hear me say something that's different and it seems to conflict with what you're reading, then you definitely need to come to me and talk. And either I will repent or I'll help you see what that passage really says. Because we're going to touch on something a little bit in a moment too that you may have been taught growing up that's not exactly what the Bible says, like I was. Okay? But the thought is that God wants to speak, and he wants his people to receive it with discernment. With discernment. Because listen to what he says in 2 Timothy 4:3. For the time will come when people will not put up with sound doctrine. Instead, to suit their own desires, they will gather around them a great number of teachers to say what their itching ears want to hear. Now, I could easily ask, do we see that happening today? You know, I mean, it's happening. It has been happening. It always happens because that's our nature. But he goes on to say, is it there? Nope. Okay. He goes on to say, 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17, all scripture is breathed out by God and is profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete and equipped for every good work. So he says, test everything. And that's the discernment part I was talking about. He says, look, don't shut out what God wants to say to you and to all of us. Don't shut that out. Make sure you are listening to God. And you're listening to God. I get it. I've had people say, I felt the Lord wanted me to say to you. And I listened to what they had to say, and I was like, I don't think that was from Jesus. I don't think that was from God the Holy Spirit, just so you know, because he lives inside of me too. And there was no confirmation. That didn't even make sense. I think I've told you guys that before, that I had a friend of mine that she would constantly preface what she had to say. You know, I felt like God wanted to say to me, I was like, you know what, sweetheart? And Rachel knows, when a correction's coming, I call you sweetheart. I said, sweetheart, you say what you need to say, and let the fruit show that that was from God. Now, I knew her, and she's very sweet, and she spent a lot of time right here. Laurie Johnson spent a lot of time right here. And so I listened to what she had to say. because I knew her. So think about that. God is saying, I want you to test and see. Test it. Test everything. You don't have to just accept everything. You can test it. But how? How are they supposed to test it? How are we supposed to test it? And man, you got to watch this one YouTube video. Boy, he just really spells it out. How do you know if he's teaching the truth? He's good at what he's doing. He's persuasive. How do you know if it's the truth? Heck, Proverbs says that. He says, one man appears to be right until somebody comes and questions him. Ask a good question, then you go, whoa, yeah, how about that? How do you test? You test based upon teaching. If somebody says something that differs with this, because they had the Old Testament, they also had the teachings of Paul. And Paul says that in his other letters. He was like, hey, don't let anybody fool you. Watch out for the false teachers. If they say something that goes against what I've said to you in the name of the Lord Jesus, if it goes against the traditions I've given to you or the way I've lived, reject it. So that's one test. He said, measure it up according to the teachings that you've been given, that where your salvation came from. And that's, fortunately, by the grace of God, we have it. That's one way we protect ourselves. We hold on to the teachings of Christ and make sure it, teachings of Christ and teaching of his apostles, and make sure it lines up. The other test that even Jesus told them to use was fruit of the person. Jesus said, watch out for false teachers, false prophets. They want to raise themselves up and they want to tell you what they think, and they'll twist things, but they'll make it sound good, take a little bit of truth, and then put something else in there. Okay? And how do you know? You line it up with Scripture, but you also look at their life. Guess what? You can't do that on YouTube. You can't examine their life on YouTube. What do you know about these teachers that you're listening to on YouTube? What do you know of their life? Because Jesus said, if you want to be, you're going to rely on their teachings, you better look at the fruit of their life. You guys voted to make me the lead pastor of this church after 4 years of watching me, right? That's the only reason why I hope that you guys voted as you did. It's because you're like, we've listened to him and we watched him, and the Spirit's confirming that this is what he wants for us. And hopefully he'll get a little bit better. He'll get better at this as we go. I feel like that assistant coach who just got promoted. It was like, you know, give him a year, give him a couple years, he'll figure it out. And guess what? I will. You know why? Because God, the Holy Spirit, lives inside of me. And he lives inside of you, because I ain't doing this alone. And we want to be on fire. for God. And your confidence is where? In Him. In Him. Lord, grant us discernment to see. Because that's what He said. Test everything. And He goes on to say, well, I'm skipping a lot here. I had a lot more. Hold fast to what's good and abstain from everything that's evil. Now, again, this is the other thing I want to talk about. I grew up Baptist. No offense. I loved my upbringing. I memorized Scripture. I mean, it was great. I'm thankful for it. There are churches like that, like those, like mine, that can tend to start to get a little legalistic. They start going, you got to behave. Anybody grew up in a church like that? It may not have been Baptist. Okay, that's just me. That's my upbringing. Just that one in particular or two, you know, where it's just like, you need to behave. And that's what God cares about. Oh, He cares about your heart too, but you got to behave. And so we start trying to control behavior. And so when I heard this scripture, avoid, now this is the King James Version, okay? King James Version, which I grew up with, said avoid all appearance of evil. Now really, there's nothing wrong with that wording, but it's the interpretation of it. If it looks bad, don't do it. Now there's some wisdom in that, okay? But the way it was applied to me, you didn't even walk by the liquor store. Somebody might see you walk by their liquor store. You got to walk on that block. Don't even walk by it. Might look like something. You avoid all appearance of evil. And now some of these other translations, they got it a little bit more right. It says, avoid every kind of evil, every form of evil. And so really, the word is, it's an appearing of it. It's there. It's not, it's like real. If something comes out and it's evil, don't have anything to do with it. Not just how it looks, okay? And again, praise God, as time goes on, you keep spending time in the Word, all of a sudden you come across it and go, oh, taught me something different. That's not what it says. But I've got it in my hand now. Where's your Bible? You got your own? You should. It doesn't have to be this, you know, it could be electronic, that's fine. But you should have one. God wants you to have one. He wants you to know it. He wants you to help you understand it. You might need a little help. That's fine. Praise God, He wants to speak to us. I think that's the message God wanted to give me. There we go. Let's pray. Lord, may we be on fire for You. Lord, we do pray. Would You please put this other fire out? In the booklets area, Lord, please have mercy. Protect lives and put that fire out. But Lord, fan into flame our fire for You. Fan it, Lord. And bear your wonderful gifts in us, Lord. Give us discernment of the gifts that You want to use, You want to keep using in us, Lord, and through us. Let us help each other. May we be grounded in Your word. May it be rich in us. May we bear Your good fruit. Thank You, Holy Spirit, for saving us. Thank You, God, for redeeming us. Thank You for loving us. May we love You, and may we continue to grow and mature and let You rule and reign in our lives and in our church. Rule and reign, Jesus, by the power of Your Spirit. Rule and reign. Pray in Your name. Amen.
The Savior's blood died.
should die for me. Amazing love, how can it be that thou, my God, should die for me? He left his father's throne above, so free, so infinite his grace, emptied himself of all but love, and bled for Adam's helpless race. 'Tis mercy all immense and free, for oh my God, it found out me. Amazing love, how can it be that thou, my God, shouldst die for me? And spirit lay fast bound in sin and nature's night. Thine eye diffused a quickening ray. I woke the dungeon flame with light. My chains fell off, my heart was free. I rose with forth and follow thee. Amazing love, how can it be that thou, my God, shouldst die for me?
No condemnation.
No condemnation now I dread. Jesus and all in him is mine. Alive in him, my living head, and clothed in righteousness. That thou, my God, shouldst die for me.
Lord, we praise you for the truth in everything that we sang. Thank you that you've set us free. May we live free this week, not to indulge a sinful nature, but to love you and to love others. Thank you, Jesus, for being our righteousness. Thank you, God, for providing the means for righteousness and hope. Lord, fill up our cup. Let it overflow to those around us. First to our families, and then to our neighbors, and then to anyone else, Lord, you run us into, Lord. Use us this week, God, to share your goodness, your love, and your truth. We pray for this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Have a great week. Hey, guys, we're going to have that church meeting in about 10 minutes, okay? So if you're a member, please stick around. We got a little bit of business to take care of. Thank you.